Jasmine was one of my childhood best friends. Throughout my life, I have yo-yoed between incredible bouts of bullying, either at school, home, or workplace, or moments of absolute fame and popularity. Hence my curiosity for when my fame era returns. Now that I know this truth, bottom or top, you will always have a friend, a frenemy, and an enemy. Jasmine became all and my first lesson in that truth. Often our schoolyard interactions were us both mutually walking around under our invisibility cloaks, exchanging stickers, collectibles, and conversations while trying not to look too seen so as not to ignite bullying. Throughout school, I was a strange beast. Kids found me goofy and smart, which meant they either loved or hated me, and if they wanted to be king or queen of the schoolyard, bullied me. Yet Jasmine's problem was that she was weak, annoying, and slightly dumb. Too eager to enter social circles, which is why, whenever accepted, it was usually on a dare or trying to make her eat some weird lunchyard concoction like Jell-O mixed with chocolate milk and celery. One day, our bullies caught us from our invisibility and gave one of the cruelest ultimatums ever given to third graders. "Hey, Deandra, you can be friends with us, but Jasmine can't," asked the Regina George of K-8. I very righteously, wearing my St. Joan of Arc armor and having a cloud filled with rainbows and hummingbirds over my head, replied, "No, that is wrong. If Jasmine can't play with us, then I can't either." I looked at Jasmine in solemnity and solace, with a sisterhood of the traveling pants energy and apparently in a British accent. I could just imagine our future as besties, speaking on this day of loyalty we had shown to each other as we traveled the world and signed each other's size 16 jeans. Regina smiled. Until this day, I'm convinced that little girl was actually a 48-year-old woman working for corporate trying to pass. She truly was diabolical. "How about you, Jasmine? You could be our friend if you leave Deandra." "Sure," Jasmine said. Quickly, very quickly, by the way, and skipped right to them. She looked back, slightly coy, and said, "Sorry, Deandra, I wanted to be their friend." I was crushed. I had had my opportunity to get rid of that traitorous bitch, and instead I let her stab me like Caesar. It was a lesson that stayed with me. Just because someone is down does not mean they are necessarily good, or down for the same reasons you are. For example, that a homeless guy that chased me down four blocks yelling at me to give him my kitty cat. He may have been down and out, but that did not stop him from trying to down me. For most of my life, I've always helped the needy, while feeling that the powerful were oddly threatened by me, like I was some untapped power that the minute realized would push them from their throne. But Jasmine was the homeless guy. No throne in sight. By the end of the lunch hour, Regina and the mean girls were officially over Jasmine. Apparently, she slurped her Danone yogurt in front of them, making loud, gushy noises, and their nausea for her and Animal Planet returned. Later that day, Regina approached me and said, "I just wanted to show you, Deandra. She wouldn't have chose you." My mouth was agape. The third-grade Worcester teachers had given me a massive lesson. For fun, friendships based on how isolated you are from others is not exactly a blood bond, which I treated it so. I thought that made me a good person, and had Jasmine been one, it would have been true. Yet she really was a loser, and I was a false saint, my goodness leaving me unprotected and up for sacrifice for no reason or God. Within the next few months, I would start hanging out with Regina and became determined to make new friends. And I actually grew popular, to Jasmine's lonely chagrin. My mother was elated that I had not let Jasmine's betrayal define me and actually turned it into motivation to redefine myself. "Don't worry, she'll get her karma," my mom said in her comforting tone, and she was not wrong. Turns out getting bullied without a companion feels much worse, and Jasmine and her mom decided to report me as her bully for no longer hanging out with her, and because I made fun of her Sailor Moon wig. Of course, nothing happened to me, but then something did happen to her. A few months later, Jasmine's mother died, and she was officially orphaned. She moved in with her 88-year-old grandparents, and while the schoolyard and Regina looked at her with pity, no one tried to be her friend, including me. I did not want to make the same mistake that I had made with Jasmine the first time, thinking that when someone is down, you use yourself to lift them up and write a Disney movie in your head about the power of unity. Of course, I sent my condolences and noticed that for the next few years and even in high school, it was Jasmine that stopped looking for friends. Ugh. Damn, that took a dark turn, but it's true. Jasmine was like my first best friend as a little girl. And she was, I want to say she was sweet, but in the end we learned that she wasn't. She was very silly, dumb. She was dumb. She was not good at intelligence. Very quiet. And she seemed sweet to me. And, you know, when you're a kid, you're not dissecting personalities, or maybe I wasn't. I think in hindsight, and it's something that I have faced a lot in work and in friendships and even relationships with men, I am a leader that doesn't want the role of leader. I take charge, and at first, everyone loves it because I come off helpful and determined, and I ignite the part of you that wants to be a leader, but I also ignite the part of you that realizes you're not. It's kind of like I'm the CEO, but he's the label of CEO. And eventually, he's going to get annoyed that I have all the traits, especially the creativity, that he doesn't have despite having the role and the paycheck. My attitude is, if someone, you know, what is the saying? Smart people keep smarter people around. My attitude is, if you're paying me to be great, then pay me to be great. Like, I can't replace you at your own company. I can't replace you at your own life. Like, at least love the fact that I'm awesome and I love you enough or want to get paid enough to not usurp you, which I can't. But it's something that I have found often. And when I look back on that moment was like super traumatic for me, because she Regina, I called her Regina George. That wasn't her name. But I don't remember her name. I remember that, like, it's crazy because I put that she kind of looked like a 48-year-old corporate woman that trying to pass. She, at that moment, to me, looked so adult. And it was such an adult thing to do. Very diabolical, which is like, you've got to choose. And I obviously did my show of We Are Sisters for Life. And Jasmine was like, bye. She left me so quick. She just turned around like, sorry, bitch. And the next few months, we hated each other. I was kind of like, F you. I can't stay in this isolation circle, like just running around the schoolyard, trying not to be seen, because if we're seen, we get bullied, or we get I was over it. So I tried to make friends, and I actually made friends with Regina, and not really with her, but I started hanging out with her because it turned out that she kind of liked me. Again, that weird frenemy energy. She liked me, but she liked people under her. And I'm a person that I really have to accept I'm a leader. I just have to. Anyway, this is all third grade. I started hanging out with more people, and Jasmine was still getting bullied, but I was not going to help her. And she wore this weird hairdo wig, and I made a joke, and her mother reported me. And everybody made a joke, but she reported me. And I felt like it was, you know, Jasmine went with them for that lunch hour. And by the end of the lunch hour, she was back to being like a turd on the sidewalk to them. And maybe in her head, in the same way in my head, I was writing a Disney movie about friendship. Maybe in her head, this was the beginning of, you know, her being popular. And kind of hanging out with the kids that hang out with other kids and not just us in our invisibility cloaks. Like, maybe she had a delusion. I don't know. But it ended. And I think there was a part of her, or at least a part of her mom, that thought I would It was a moment. Don't, she just chose. You guys are friends. Don't worry. But I was really hurt. And that wouldn't be the first time I had to learn that that wouldn't be the last time I had to learn that lesson, but it was the first time. And when you cross me, you're out. Like, you're done. You're buried. Bye. I will leave your ass. And she crossed me, and it's a good quality to have. I wish that I just didn't let losers enter. But it's a good quality to know I could let them go, right? And a few months later, yikes, big yikes, Jasmine's mom died, and her dad had died when she was one. And she was kind of a miracle baby to her mom, and it was so incredibly tragic. Like, it was, everybody was crying because it was just like the craziest death. And then, parents were crying because it made them super existential. Kids were crying because they were like, wow, we could lose our mommies. And nobody really befriended her, including me. Everybody was kind to her. Everybody was gracious, but she was annoying. And it was, God, that's a terrible thing to say. And I think for me, I kind of learned the lesson the first time, which is just because somebody is down doesn't mean they will actually love you when they're back up again. And I just felt like I would be fake or weird, and I just didn't know how to approach the situation. Here was my first betrayal, being betrayed by life. And I didn't want to be her friend again, but I did want to be kind to her. And what I realized is when I would have these moments of kindness, with her, hey, how are you? Kind of. I think I sat down with her a few times, but she didn't talk. And oh God, this makes me super sentimental now in perspective. I realized it was something that I realized. We went to pretty much, we spent our entire school years together. And I remember passing her in high school and she smiled. And I realized I had never seen her with friends. Never. But I also realize she stopped looking for them after her mom died. Like, she just stopped trying to be in circles. Oh my God, that makes me so sad. And I only saw, which I guess is the happy ending. It was only until like the second to last year of high school that I started to see her join clubs and try to be friends with people. But yeah, she really kind of shut down. And I think ultimately what this story teaches me is this lesson of trauma bonding. Just because you share the same pain with somebody doesn't mean you share the same definitions of love. They're totally different energies. And growing up, my family, shame and motivation were one and the same. Bullying and being funny were one and the same. Being numb and being positive was one and the same. And I really thought that was the first friendship that kind of taught me a big warning that I would have throughout my life. Do not trauma bond and think you have a genuine friendship. Yeah. Whoa, that turned. Anyway, check out daddyrecovery.com. Check out DeAndra on all music platforms. Follow me on my socials, BBs. Oofed. Oofed.